Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everyone. This is Rafe Khan coming at you from somewhere in North Carolina. This is September 1st, 2016, and today I have a special treat for everyone. I am uploading for the first time an episode from my D&D campaign that I run about twice a month with a great group of players playing a motley group of characters who have named themselves the Protectors. In Toril, the date is the 18th of Alturiac, 1404 by Dale Reckoning. And the Protectors have been working to slowly uncover a conspiracy of lies and deceit that includes the smuggling of weapons, armors, and other things an army would need to help supply an orcish horde to the north. The mystery was that while the supplies entered the warehouse, they never left. So the Protectors must discover how they are moving those supplies out of Everlund. Also, they learned that the councilman, Melvin Draga, seems to be a party to this operation, though they're not entirely sure how. If you'd like to know more about the Protectors' adventures leading up to this episode, I will provide a link to the campaign website below in the description. And as always, if you enjoy watching this video, please remember to hit the like button and also subscribe to my channel, as more content will be forthcoming. And without further ado, enjoy the first episode of The Protectors on YouTube. Okay, so, last session, you guys... Emeraldi, Banner, and Beetle were intercepted by a messenger that basically invited you to... I knew I should have pulled that up. To the councilwoman... I'm still pulling it up. Hold on.
I got it.
Beryl, I think, right?
Yeah, Beryl.
Beryl Ruidin.
Yes. Yes. And you guys went to her rather large, opulent estate, discovered some self-sizing slippers, and you guys heard about the story of Ketes, the Paladin of Tyr, from several hundred years ago from kind of the councilwoman's childhood. You guys learned that the paladin became the unwitting consort to the Merilith Queen, who at the time was posing as a moon elf named Marleth. Marla. Yep.
Marla.
And so Marla was kidnapped, and basically the paladin Ketes, the councilwoman at the time, she was an Akfair mage of the Elvish Empire, and along with a collection of other Akfair mages and paladins following Ketes. Only to find out that, the avatar or the priest was actually possessed by Moandar himself, which was an ancient god of death. And after defeating the possessed priest, Marla made herself known and disappeared with Ketes. So in love with Marla was Ketes that after he accidentally, in a rage of battle, killed another paladin of Tyr, was basically rejected by Tyr quite forcefully and nearly killed, his armor fusing to his body. Long story short, the councilwoman believed that... agents of the Merilith Queen were trying to resurrect or revive the broken paladin, and considering the fact that the Merilith Queen, if she was indeed on this world somewhere, in working with the forces at large, would be one of the first things that she would try to do. You guys arrived barely in the nick of time before the Paladin Kentess was able to fully restore to his full strength and defeated him as he was still weak, sending him back to the underworld. And after that victorious moment in which, you know, the lopping of Kenta's head and the bouncing of it across the floor ensued, you guys headed back. Emeraldi Beetle and Banner headed back. And Banner was looking around to find some small game. In vain, apparently, while Beetle was just kind of picking them off left and right. Managed to gather up no fewer than five conies. Excuse me. Right about now, it's about 5 o'clock. At this time of year, the sun sets early, so it is quickly becoming dark. As a matter of fact, sun begins to set and you make your way through the woods. That's where we're going to pick up as you guys are continuing back.
Do you guys think we should build a campfire and rest for an hour or something? Or should we just head straight back to town?
How far are we from town now, Beamer?
You're about an hour and a half away. You probably wouldn't get there until closer to 7 o'clock.
Okay. And as you said, it's starting to get dark now?
It is. Matter of fact, in about another half hour, 45 minutes at most, it will be quite dark.
I did finally invest in a winter blanket, so I don't think I'll freeze to death if we end up having to camp out here for the night. And I don't really relish the thought of making our way back to town in the dark. Shall we make camp? And I'm very interested in this beer-braised coney that you've been promising us, Banner. I would like to see this happen.
I aim to please. I'll do my best. Yeah, let's fire up I think Emeraldi's looking forward to it, too. I know I've been. And, you know, that was some thirsty work back there. Did you guys see how far that guy's head went? I mean, I think it was some kind of record. I've decapitated a lot of guys in my line of work, but that was... I mean, what do you think the distance was on that?
Oh, gosh, at least 15 feet. At least.
Okay. I'll have to write that down somewhere sometime. Or not. Emeraldi,
what say you?
Well, certainly could do a nice warming up of my bones. And could use a nice rest. Took a hit in that fight.
Yeah. Actually, speaking of rest, I don't suppose either of you is skilled at all in treating a few wounds. I gave pretty good back there, but I think I got pretty good too.
That's okay, the door.
Okay. Right here. Hold still.
Stick I'm out holding your tongue. Still. Say ah.
Hold still. This will only take a minute. Sorry. Couldn't resist.
This is getting awkward, Emeraldi. I mean, I like you. You fight good.
All right. So
seven?
Yeah. Emeraldi extends a hand, just kind of lays a hand on your shoulder in a camaraderie-like fashion and, you know, kind of just chilling out, and you feel some warmth kind of spread from where his hand was on your pauldron, and as you regain some vitality.
Okay. I'm gonna roll some hit dice while we're resting real quick just to get that last bit back.
You can absolutely do that. Matter of fact, everyone make a survival check as you guys look around for a good place to set up at least a campfire to cook up these conies, as I assume that's what you guys are wanting to do.
Emerald is going to use the last bit of his lay on of hands for himself. I think he's got maybe 10 hit points left of this pool.
Okay, go ahead. Or alternatively, you also can use hit dice to recover some of your hit points as well. So, Banner...
Well, we are going to be sleeping tonight, so I'll be a long rest.
Banner and Beetle, you both pretty much see the same stand of pines almost at the same moment, and it becomes a little bit of a contest to see who can get there first as you both race for it, leaving a rather busy Emeraldi as he's placing his hand on his self, going, oh, Baranar, heal me, and, you know, saying a brief prayer to Baranar, and you guys are already in the stand and busily sitting, clearing a place away for a fire. You guys quickly manage to skin, gut, and otherwise prepare the conies as a fire... as the fire gets going. Unfortunately, Banner, you do on the way. Beetle did manage to get there first. As running, you suddenly, with no apparent reason, pitch forward and land flat on your face in the snow, receiving a good old fashioned face washing.
I jump up. What? I don't know what.
What are you talking about?
At which time, Emeraldi, you finally catch up to the other two jokesters. As you guys.
Really, guys? A race?
It's been a long day. We should have
a little
fun. Kind of
lighten the mood a little bit when you put your life on the line.
You two are so impatient. You guys are going to have to be patient if you want to cook these conies right with beer. You're going to have to be patient.
All right. I know what I'm doing. How about you hand those here and I start getting to work?
So Emeraldi puts the cask down and goes, well, have at it. I can't wait.
What kind of cooking check do you want me to make, Beamer?
That is a really good question because I have no clue. There's not a cooking skill, so... I'm just going to say
go with charisma. I'm gonna cocktail this. I'm gonna flip some things around like
Kabachi chef.
Yes.
I'll go with
just not intelligence, please.
Well, that was one of the directions I was going. Let's just do a flat wisdom check with advantage.
Oh, but I have cook's utensils proficiency. That's what I'm trying
to
figure.
Do. Oh,
yeah, yeah. Well,
and, okay, yeah. So all that does is allows you to add proficiency to your role. Any kind of tools.
To make a flat wisdom and add proficiency to it.
That's correct. Okay. So it'd be a d20 plus 2 in your case.
Okay.
With advantage. Well, there you go. So you're able to make a decent coney. You didn't burn it. That was the important part. And as you guys, you know, sniff it, and it's smelling good, and the beer is just kind of boiling off the alcohol, and you get this really good. By the way, Emeraldi, what kind of ale beer did you use?
I believe this was just kind of a beechwood aged, light yellow beer.
All right. So you definitely
get
that.
It basically
nice
dwarfed and... mouthwash.
All right. So about 30, 45 minutes pass, and Banner, you managed to make a good some good conies. Not burnt, a little well done, but otherwise tastes pretty good.
Better than your average tavern.
It is better than your average tavern.
All right.
Just a little.
Well, what do you guys think? You might have something here.
All right. That's what I like to hear.
I raise my little haunch of rabbit and like clink, like cheers.
All right. Banner starts biting in. He doesn't just hands nothing. Yeah. Fair enough. All right.
So my question is, do you guys want to take a long rest here, or are you guys just going to eat and then continue on taking a short rest?
I mean, did we tell people we were leaving?
I think it'd be wise to make this a small rest. It'd be better to be inside city walls. So there could be bears or yetis.
I agree.
All
right. Just a word of warning, you guys have been burning the candle on both ends of the stick, so to speak, the last couple days. So you could probably make it back to the city, but it'll be another late night. So as you guys are eating, just kind of enjoying the silence of the wood, the calls of the wolves in the distance, all of a sudden, you hear in the distance this loud yipping and growling sound. Beetle and Emeraldi, you both recognize this sound as wargs.
Oh, boy.
You
okay, get your weapons, boys.
You, man.
You both, oh, man, already? Good thing I used this hit dice.
you both recognize the sound as wargs because you have fought them before, along with howling growl of orcs.
Did we get a full short rest in?
Yes, you did.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to roll a hit die real quick.
Yep, roll any hit dice you want. Oh, wow.
You rolled as good as I did. Don't forget, you two both still have potions that the Varel gave us.
Not wasting my potion on this.
I'm just telling you in case something bites your leg off.
And to be fair,
I still had all my hit dice.
Well, Emeraldi is out of healing spells.
You all three.
But you got a short rest in, so you should be good, right?
Oh, Palin's got to have a long rest for any spell or lay on of hands.
Oh, I didn't realize that. All right.
All three of you, you hear this battle going on, what sounds like a battle, although it is quite distant. It sounds like it's coming roughly from your southwest of where you're at.
I look at the guys, sigh, stand up, and strap my weapons back on.
Well, I mean, this is some Banner. Sort of animal fight. I mean, I'm not getting in no animal fight.
Well, there are wargs.
Are we sure about that?
Where there are wargs, there are usually orcs, in my experience.
You do.
Do we want orcs this close to Everlund?
You do hear the sound of at least a couple of orcs, along with the sound of the growling of wargs and the yips of pain, the screams of pain. What do you want? What do you do?
Well, can we see through the woods, or is it getting pretty dark right now? I mean, I got low light vision up to 120 feet, but
well, I mean,
we're gonna be stumbling through the woods. We're gonna get hurt.
Beyond the confines of the campfire, Banner, you can't see anything. It's dark up at this point. We're close enough. However, Beetle and Emeraldi, you can see pretty well, given that you have dark vision, so there's nothing really keeping you from being able to see around. You don't see the wargs or the orcs for that.
Then after that fight, and he just starts howling like a wolf and chasing after the noises.
Like, great, that's super sneaky. Good job.
So you're just storming through the woods, blind as a bat?
Oh, am I? Is it that dark? There's no moon.
It is dark.
All right, I'll rescind that if that's all right. I mean, if I'm gonna run into a tree,
I'll let you. I was about ready to make you dexterity check here.
Sorry, I forgot you said it was that dark.
I just wanted to see how many trees you ran into. Okay, so how are you guys proceeding exactly?
So Beetle, you want to try another a BB special with some elemental illusions?
With the side of Emeraldi?
Yeah, I got a little juice left. Although, it might be a good idea if they don't know we're here if we just sneak up on them.
Okay, that sounds good too. I can try and sneak. I can try.
What kind of armor are you wearing again?
I am in disadvantaged right
now. No, we got you that breastplate.
I don't think it will fit Banner. He's 6'5", and it was on a... that's up to Beamer. I don't know. He'll have to tell me whether it's fitted.
I thought
it belonged to a human, so...
It was the cleric's armor.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Yeah, it was all human woman, I'm pretty sure.
Well, I'm back. I guess technically you could. You would just have breasts.
Oh, wait, it's like inappropriately made armor?
No, I'm just messing with you.
okay, so if that's the case and it didn't have to be fitted, I think what Banner wanted to do was just draw an X through that symbol in the middle while he was short resting with like he has a dagger, so he just kind of etched an X through it just for the sake of RP. I just wanted to say that. But he can go ahead and throw that on. Then, if that was the case, can we retcon that if that's the case? I assumed he had to have it, retrofitted.
Well, I will assume that while you're doing your eating and stuff, you will have done that.
Okay.
I'm putting an end to the whole retcon thing.
Okay.
Unless it's, a huge, huge mistake, because that's driving me nuts.
Okay.
All right, so make stealth rolls if you want to make stealth rolls. Don't if you don't.
I do. I always do.
What's the opposite of a stealth roll?
Is it rocky terrain here, or is it just woods?
It's basically old growth pine and paper birch. You got snow covering the ground, but the ground is somewhat rocky.
Then I get advantage.
Yes, you do, and you basically become once again a ghost. Unfortunately. As you are stealthily making your way forward, Emeraldi, are you going to do a stealth check or are you not going to bother? He's not.
No, I'm just going to start jogging towards the sounds. I might even call out a dwarven battle cry.
So, Beetle, you are like a ghost. You're slipping among the rocks. You're making good time. Behind you, Banner thinks he's being quiet, but you could probably hear him a mile off as he's lumbering through and, cursing under his breath as he trips over the occasional rock and trying to get through some underbrush. And you, hand back the branch and he doesn't catch it and it smacks him right in the face. Meanwhile, Emeraldi's, shouting at the top of the lung and he goes whizzing by you guys. Towards the sound. You guys continue for about 100 yards, and as you continue, you begin to hear a lower kind of throatier growl that belongs to something else. You don't know what it is, but it's ferocious. It's like you can hear it quite well, and the howls and the war cries of the orcs, one by one, dwindle, fade, and die. The wood becomes silent. You hear in the distance a kind of a high-pitched whine. as if a some kind of dog or wolf or something was in pain. And that's it. You don't hear anything. The wood falls silent.
How close did the noise sound, the dog wolf sound?
Maybe another 50 yards.
Okay. I have 120 dark vision, so I can see, what is that, 40 yards?
Yes, as long as it's an unobstructed view. Unfortunately, you are in the woods, so it's fairly obstructed.
I'm going to creep forward and see if I can see what it is up there.
Okay. As you get closer to the place from which the feeble whining sound came from, you happen beetle upon a grisly scene. Matter of fact, as you happen upon it, a charging and yelling Emeraldi burst into the small clearing where you also see the scene.
Seeing Emeraldi, I'm going to go ahead and follow him since he's not being stealthy at all.
All right. And Banner, you all come across the same scene at roughly the same time. Though Banner and Emeraldi, you do not see Beetle. She disappeared in the woodwork somewhere. You know she's probably around. You just don't see her. But you do see two dead orcs. Their faces frozen in a rictus of death. One laying in a mound of its own entrails as his abdomen was roughly torn out by sharp teeth. The other, its throat torn and its hands trying hard, unsuccessfully, to quell its lifeblood.
And is it still alive?
As you reach the clearing, he breathes his last.
Okay.
Not far away from the corpses, not far away, the corpses of two wargs, each similarly torn by sharp teeth. And as you look upon the scene, kind of look around, you see a trail of blood and the three pawed tracks of some animal to which the blood belongs hobbling away from the dead orcs.
Can I do a survival check to see if I can identify the animal?
Absolutely.
Emerald is going to go ahead and check the orc bodies and see what they have on them.
I would do too.
Banner,
he wants to identify to see if they're the same kind of orcs.
Hold on. Banner, where did you want the dead animal?
I wanted to see if I could identify the animal by the footprints leading away.
Oh, okay. Looking at the tracks, you were able to see these big paw prints of what looked to be unmistakably either a very large wolf of some type or something else entirely. You believe, based on, you know, things you've heard other mercs talk about during their time as you were, you know, running jobs together, whatever, that it may belong to a dire wolf.
So I don't know where Beetle is still. Is that
Beetle?
Oh, at this point, I will kind of creep up right behind you and slap you on the shoulder and be like, "What do we got here?"
Dang, you're good at that.
forget it.
I don't know. It looks like we've got some kind of wolf on our hands. Actually, if you two hang back a minute, I might follow this trail. But hang. You're pretty good at this. Just keep your distance and let me try something out here.
Okay.
Does Emerald get a chance to search the orc's body, see if they what they got on them?
Do an investigation check. And Beetle, if you want to do an investigation check.
Always.
Yeah, there were bodies, Emeraldi. You managed to find a grand total of two coppers. Beetle, quite a lot more thorough, manages to come up with a grand total of about 10 gold. Orcs aren't particularly rich.
What kind of weapons do they have on them?
These weapons are more of the same. As you look at their weapons and their armor, they do have the maker's mark of Helk's Silverbeard.
I announce it to our companions. Oh, these orcs are wearing the same kind of a Helk's arms here. So this is still same the part of the same damn problem.
You know, let's take those. The council might want some proof.
Okay.
Now that the jig is up on what's going on.
Yeah. Okay. What can I take?
There is a couple of long swords. The orcs themselves are just wearing regular chainmail. There's not really a maker's mark on the chainmail, obviously, but it's like sewn into a leather tag on the back.
I'm going to take a couple of orc ears just so that we have proof that there were orcs here, because we're not going to take the bodies with us, I assume.
All right. You definitely cut off their ears.
Banner gets excited. Good idea.
Emerald, you'll take one of the long swords.
Okay. All right. So after
do you... Do I need to light a torch to follow this trail, or is it that dark?
Well, yeah. I mean, you are generally blind at this point.
Okay. I'm gonna light a torch up, keep it low burning, and follow this trail. And again, and just say have Emeraldi and Beetle follow maybe like 15 paces behind or something like that.
Okay. All right, so...
And I'm going to draw my glaive, at least at this point, and carry the torch and just...
All right. So, following the tracks a little further, you see the... a fourth paw occasionally touch the snowy ground as it tries to make its way over rocky ground. And after maybe another 100 yards... that's kind of winding through trees and rocks. It's kind of hard going. The tracks in the blood trail lead into a cave with a small opening, likely a den of some sort.
So I'm going to go in here, and if I don't come out in 5 minutes, come save my life.
Tracking a wounded animal into its den, always a wise decision. Good luck! Don't die.
So I guess I'll just sort of slowly make my way in and investigate what's going on in here.
Okay. As you step into the den, are you trying to be quiet?
I'm trying to appear... What's that?
With a torch in your hand.
I'm just saying no, but I'm trying to appear non-threatening. I'm just taking things slow, that I can stop right away if I need to, that kind of thing.
All right. As you step into the den, you hear a soft whine, followed by a very low growl that fills the den as a gust of wind carries your scent to the creature. Your torchlight falls upon the dire wolf. Lycan, what does Banner see?
As he approaches through the den, he sees not only the dire wolf, but a bunch of mangled other wolves that have died recently, it looks like. And as he starts to approach, all he hears is...
Okay. Should I describe Banner at this point, or...?
If you'd like.
Sure.
Okay. So Banner... Hang on here. Let me pull it up. So Banner, what you see is a fairly tall human figure standing about 6'5", very dark features. He, at first glance from a distance, he would look fairly lithe and thin framed, but as he approaches closer, you see that that's sort of an illusion created by his height, and that he's just muscles just thinly packed on his body. And despite all these dark features and scars, he doesn't seem to carry with him a dark expression, but rather he seems like an approachable individual. Although in this moment, he might look slightly serious walking into a cave. So I guess that about sums it up. So Banner's gonna, is the wolf, did you say the dire wolf is sort of laying down at this point?
Yes, he's definitely laying down. Kind of in the shadows in the back of the den.
Banner's gonna stop.
You can tell that the wolf is injured. Actually, Lycum, you are actually not at full health.
I think you said 10?
Yes.
Okay.
You're at 10 hit points right now.
Okay.
That's for my wolf form, right?
So Banner's going to take a knee to kind of get on eye level with this wolf at a distance where it can hear him, but is definitely at least 10 feet, like glaive distant.
at least.
And he's going to say, and Banner's going to say, he's going to put up a hand, or put out both his hands. He's going to say, peace, friend.
As you put out both your hands, I stand up in whatever way I can, even though I'm injured. My back is tense, and it's kind of arched, and I bare my teeth at you.
Peace, brother. I am Banner. I am consort to Talia, the Lady of Wolves. I can see that you are a strong warrior who's seen many winters. I have no doubt that she may have called upon you at one time for one of her hunts. Perhaps you know of her. Perhaps you do not. But trust that I am a friend and a brother to your kind. How can I help you?
All you get is more growling. Just not sure what to do. Keeping an eye on you, watching your every move.
Beetle calls in.
What's that?
Beetle calls in. You dead yet?
So in
we got a bet going on, Banner, that if you don't get your legs bit, or if you don't get a scratch on your ass, one of us is going to be 2 gold richer.
So, in the silence of this solemn moment, you hear the irreverent voices of Beetle and Emeraldi echoing through the cave.
Banner has a serious moment, and no. All right, so Banner is actually going to take a few steps back. He's going to kind of back his way back out of the cave, and he's going to ask, he's going to say, give me one of those potions that you guys got. Let me try one more thing. And if not, we can head on our way. I don't know how much good we can do here.
Well, what's in there?
A angry, bleeding dire wolf. I think you're on mute.
Beetle, you think you could put it to sleep? I might be able to use my bandages to bind it up a little bit.
That's not a bad idea.
Or it could attack us after that. I think you underestimate the adrenaline this thing has in its system right now. I don't think it's going to sleep.
Well, we got any leftover food to feed it so it knows that you're a friend? I mean, you had your hands all up that rabbit's yahoo, and you probably smell like prey.
That's true.
Good point.
I have
in my pocket, and I hand over my rabbit.
All right. I'll take the rabbit.
And you were saying, Beamer, that I do smell it?
Oh, yeah. You smell a really strong scent of coney. Freshly killed, maybe an hour and a half.
give me... It's probably no use for Banner to try it. Did you say you have bandages?
That's right. Right, I've been trained a little bit of first aid and medicine.
Okay. Why don't you come in with me this time, then?
Oh, whoa, wait a minute.
All right, then.
You want me to go to a small space, strapped with you, tall giant, and a raging, crazy direwolf.
I didn't say he was crazy.
That
raging,
sounds like
maybe.
A great plan. You guys go in there. I'll play lookout.
Yeah, because you'd be able to jump up the tree if that bad boy kills both of us.
He killed two wargs and two orcs. I mean, worst case scenario, we throw him in a cage and drag him into somewhere with us and let him loose. And he could do some damage.
That's a terrible thing to
do. I'm not sure that's even anywhere close to any report of reality. But I'll go in there with you. If not,
right,
I'll have
great.
To play my battle.
I was just trying to convince Emeraldi. If I did it, then success. All right, let's go.
Well, I'll put my shield in front of me.
All right. So, Lycum, you see this Emeraldi, describe yourself.
Oh, well, he's got a helm. It's got some big ogre tusks in the front of it. He's adorned in magnificent dwarven plate. He has a battle hardened shield and kind of an old looking battle axe. He's got a light brown beard and a jolly face.
So you see this dwarf kind of inching into the cave. It's probably the first time you've ever seen a dwarf actually afraid of entering into a cave. As he inches forward, his shield upraised, not knowing what to expect.
Banner is going to take the same posture he did the last time, but he's going to pull out the coney that Beetle gave him, and he's going to hold it up. He's going to hold it up and just see how this direwolf reacts to it.
He still looks very threatening, and he's still growling at you, but you can see a little bit of recognition in his eyes that you have food. Also that you are food, but you have cooked food stuff in front of him that could take priority over you.
So I guess Banner will, let's see. He's going to throw it midway between him and the wolf. So basically there's 10 feet between them and it's right in the middle, which would put them 5 feet apart if the wolf walked up and took it.
Yep. And Lycum will take a couple steps forward, watching, keeping a close eye on you guys. How far am I from the coney at that point? Where am I at?
Well, it's about 5 feet from where you were, so...
Okay. So I'll take like 2 steps forward, keeping an eye on them. And then what I will do is I will reach forward as fast as I can and pull it back and then retreat back to the corner.
All right. So that's...
All right, Emeraldi, you're up, my friend. Start with the bandages while he's busy.
Emeraldi's actually going to kind of start slow. He's still keeping his shield up, but he's actually going to kind of start to softly sing a dwarven lullaby.
So, as Lycum sees you moving towards him, he automatically is looking at you. He stops what he was doing and he just starts growling. But as you start doing the lullaby, as Banner has spoken in common just a little bit ago, you start to see a little bit of recognition in his face of something other than what he's known for the past while. You're jogging his memory on things.
So he's singing it. Okay.
Lycum, do you know Dorvich? You don't.
Probably not. No, I don't. It's not one of my notes.
But you do recognize that it is Dorvich.
Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, that's.
So is Emeraldi finished, or is he gonna sing?
Emerald is inching closer to see if singing makes the beast not so hackled of the fur.
And as you continue to singing. He's definitely relaxing more and more. He starts to nibble back on his food while keeping an eye on you, realizing that you're probably friendly, but still not 100% sure. And he's probably about halfway through that coney right now. It's probably like 2
Emerald is going to give some instructions to Beamer. Okay, Banner, I want you to hold my shield between his head and these wounds so I can get these bandages on without having to worry about...
Wait. Emeraldi, as much as I would love to see what happens, are you sure he's ready for that at this point?
The coney is about 3/4 of the way gone at this point. The longer you guys talk, he's going to continue to eat.
Let's do it.
All right, Banner's going to go for it. Banner's going to do what he's asking, but he's just raising the question. and if Emeraldi's not singing anymore, Banner's going to start singing. Go ahead and start singing in Sylvan, something that he learned in his past travels, since it seemed to have an effect.
The moment you speak Sylvan, or you sing Sylvan, so you know Sylvan, is that?
I do.
That's awesome. So yeah, the moment you do that, you just see like all sorts of things change within the direwolf's posture. He's just like completely dumbfounded almost. He gives the like awkward like dog look where he tilts his head like, what is happening? yeah, and so that's kind of where he's at.
All right, Emeraldi making...
All right, Bear's going to keep singing in Sylvan.
Making medicine.
Are you guys doing anything else? Are you... continuing to
Emerald is going to go ahead and try to make a medicine attempt.
Yep, go ahead.
Can Lycum make an attack? Actually, so what I want to do with Lycum is he's going to change form out of wolf form and then cast a spell. Can I do that?
Emeraldi, first do your medicine check, and at the same time, you can drop your form at any point. And when you drop your form, you actually go to your full hit points.
Yep. So I lose the 10, essentially the 10 temporary hit points.
What spell do you wish to cast?
Thunder Wave.
Okay.
So, Thunder Wave, level 1, just kind of push them away, like, get out of my space.
Okay, go ahead.
What I'm looking to do.
All right, Banner, Emeraldi, you're sitting there basically behind the shield, holding the shield. Emeraldi, you're just starting to bend down towards the animal's injured leg. Both of you make constitution saving throws. All right. Banner, the shield pushes violently against you as the cave is suddenly... Well, you see a couple of different things happening very quickly. The first thing you see is all of a sudden the form on the ground like fades away like a mirage. And in its place, you see this tall, elvish, wild-looking man, and he opens his hands out like this, and a blast of force comes out and blows you back about 5 feet.
It's going to be very loud in there, too, in that confined space.
Yes, that's the Constitution save.
Oh, okay.
It's plus it's a spell. You take 12 points of damage. Emeraldi, having bent down, you see the sudden change and have that moment to brace yourself because you feel like something's really interesting or bad or something is about to happen, and you steel yourself against the ensuing crash, and you still take 6 points of damage, but you're not... thrown back like Banner was. And in place of the wolf now stands, go ahead and describe Lycum in his elven form.
So what you see before you now is just this scarred face a little bit. You have see different scars throughout on his skin, but you see a 5'11"-ish elven man that's standing there wearing furs as well as robes in front of you, holding a quarter staff that's just kind of gnarled at the end. His eyes catch you off guard, though. They're not what you'd normally expect to see with elven eyes. They're golden, and they have the look of wolven eyes. They're pretty much the same thing as what you saw in his direwolf form, but now just in his elven body. Yes, that's like...
Harry?
No, since I'm an elf, not Harry. But wearing furs and stuff, yes.
Okay.
Yep.
All right. Banner rubs his head and like, what? And he thinks he's not sure this is real yet since he hit his head. He's just kind of like, what in the...
And so...
Emeraldi?
Emeraldi raises his battle axe and curses in Elvish and says something about some damn bastard elves.
Okay, so like him... Coming out of that form after the spell is done, he looks at you. Do I get healed at all? Is that, like, does he actually attempt, like, get a heal off on me? I know that I
No, get hit no, once, you but... interrupted that process.
Nice, okay.
So you're at full hit points, but...
Yeah. So I look at Emeraldi first because he's the one who touched me, and I looked at him. I look at him, and I just growl first off. You get a... Speak common? Do you speak common?
Yes, of course. What's wrong with your head?
Banner starts brushing off and walking up to Emma, walking up to them while they're having this conversation now.
And I just don't touch me. It's been a long, long time since I've spoken common. And these words are so foreign anymore.
Are you guys okay in there?
We're fine.
Come on in, Beetle.
You can come in if you want. Banner in Sylvan says, is this easier for you?
And I look back at him, and in Sylvan, I say, no, not really. It is a little bit easier, but no.
All right.
So,
as you guys are talking, like him, you see a diminutive gnome, grayskin gnome, step in. Go ahead and describe yourself, you.
You're muted.
There, that's better. Yeah. Beetle's about 3'7". She's wearing charcoalish colored leather armor with a leather backpack on the part that's like kind of charcoaly, and her hair is black with a bright green streak.
Ooh, I didn't remember that.
Yeah, you never asked. and she's pretty loaded down with weapons. She's got daggers and a short sword, a short sword all over, but she hasn't drawn any of them. She's just sort of like curiously peering in. And when she sees an elf, she's like, I thought there was like an animal in here.
I think there still is.
That's not a nice thing to say about Emeraldi Banner.
Emeraldi sarcastically goes to our new elf person. Bandage you put on.
I don't need healing. I was only wounded while in my other form.
I'll take a bandage. On my head, like wrapped around, if you don't mind.
You see a laceration in Banner's head, and his blood is like gushing out, and
there's a new one.
A little rough.
As this is happening, Lycan just looks at the group and says,
"I'd probably do a medicine check on Banner."
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. And so Lycan looks at the group and says, "Who are you? Why are you here?"
Well, we heard a commotion and just thought we'd take a look and see what was going on. You seemed like you were in a bit of trouble. Well, you handled yourself well, but it seemed like you might need a little TLC afterwards.
TLC? No.
We heard the stand of orcs and wargs, and they were a little too close to Everlund for our liking.
The moment you say orcs and wargs, you get like them just...
Yeah, that's and how I feel about them, too.
They killed my den. They killed my friends. They killed everyone today. I don't know why. I don't know where they came from, but they're stronger than I've ever seen. I've been here for a long, long time. I've lived with this den of wolves for so long, longer than I can almost remember. And yet they killed them. They killed them all.
Wait. So you've been a wolf for how long?
Time. I think close to 400 winters or so. Could be plus or minus 20. I stopped counting.
Well, shoot.
What?
I'm sorry about your friends, and I hand him another piece of coney.
He just eats it, but it's not like civilized at all. He just like digs in and just gnaws on it, sort of like Banner a little bit, but even worse.
That's saying a lot.
While he's stuffing his face, I kind of turn to Banner. I'm like, did he really turn into a wolf or out of a wolf?
He kind of knocked me on my ass, so I'm not 100% sure, but it looks that way.
I look at them and I can totally hear what Beetle's saying, and I'm just like, yes, my preferred body form, whatever you might want to call it, is definitely a direwolf. Any chance I can be, I've learned over the years that is much preferable to anything else I've been.
Well, I tell you what, I'm Beetle, this is Banner, and that's Emeraldi. If you would like to see some justice for your friends, we're currently investigating why those orcs are so powerful and what we can do to stop them. They've been hurting a lot of innocent people.
I'm used to a pack. I'm used to friends. And I think that in greater numbers, we definitely can do more. I still don't know about you. I don't know what the hell you guys are doing, but... Thank you for your attempt to heal me. I'm sorry for my reaction. Just don't ever touch me again. Otherwise, that might happen again.
Noted. You hear that, Banner?
You're going to have to get over there real soon, Elf. Otherwise, you won't receive any of my healing from the goddess Faerun True Silver.
Goddess.
kind of like looking at Beetle, like, what are you talking about? I don't know. Because he thinks he was slick with the hug, but I guess he wasn't.
Yeah. To Banner, I kind of whisper, I think these two are going to get along like dwarves and elves. Great.
Banner. All
right. At this point, so you guys, as you continue talking, you make your way out of the cave. Into the full night now of the cold north. And it is cold. It's probably close to about 10, 15 below zero Fahrenheit for all of you in the U.S. I think everybody's in the U.S., so we're good. It's a crispy night, even for the north. And you guys make your way slowly towards the Silver Moon Gate of Everlund. It takes you about an hour and a half. the night deepens. It's about closer to 8 o'clock than 7 o'clock at this point. As you guys, now pretty cold, even you, Lycan, even though you're used to the cold, you are used to braving the cold in your woven form. So braving it in the elven form is a little different. And as you guys get closer to the Silver Moon Gate...
do I see it at this point?
The gate?
Yeah.
Yes.
Do I see the city? Lycan just kind of stops for a second and like looks at it, like unsure of what to do. It's been a long time since he's seen civilization and gone into civilization that he's just kind of hesitant on what to expect.
Banner goes to reach out a hand, then stops and decides instead to say in Sylvan, "It'll be okay. We're here with you."
I look at him and I say, "Wise choice."
You know, maybe we should go back to the one elven councilwoman. Maybe she'll be able to help our new friend here, help him reacquaint himself with his own kind.
We also need to get paid.
Exactly, and she'll probably feed us well, too.
Food.
I like food.
More food.
And
yeah, we should let her know what happened.
Yeah. Maybe leave
I
out
the part. I want to ask her about this necklace of Eldad.
And maybe leave out the part where I burned the body of the guy that she was in love with.
Yeah, let's just say we laid him back down. Let's just tell her that he never woke up.
No, I don't think that's a good idea. She seemed to know an awful lot. I think we say we dealt with it. You don't have to worry about him rising again, as far as we know. It's handled.
We will tell her the truth about him having his final rest.
There you go.
And as the group nears the continues towards the Silver Moon Gate, you guys actually happen upon a curious scene. You see
going around tonight
a large orc in chains sitting on a bench near the guardhouse that is just to the right of the gate. Not far away, a guard hovers nearby. And against the wall of the guardhouse, you see a collection of a traveler's pack and a few other things, a walking staff innocuously leaned against the wall. Gan, go ahead and describe yourself as you're sitting there on the bench.
Dark meat.
Right. So, as Beaner said, you guys see the orc sitting on the bench, and the first thing that would strike you about him is that, compared to a lot of the orcs you've seen, this guy's pretty old. A lot of the orcs that go around, especially around this area where there's war going on all the time, they don't get to old age. He's got, like, very silvery almost hair tied back into a ponytail, like a short little beard coming down off of him. As he's sitting there, he doesn't look particularly concerned about the fact that he's chained up or anything. He just emanates this kind of tranquility.
Half orc, though, right?
Full orc.
Oh, all right. I like this.
Ooh, Lycum's not doing okay with this right now. He's already just like bristling up, in even in elf form, he's kind of like pulling on some of his characteristics of a direwolf.
Well, this is a great night.
like he's burying.
This is out of character. I'm just like, I feel like we're on a diplomatic mission at this point. All right.
And as you guys near one of the guards, the guard near the orc says, "Ho there! What are you doing up so late?"
As the guard says that, the orc, Gon, speaks up and says, "You, dwarf, I have heard tale of you. I would speak with you."
"Okay. What have you to say, orc?"
"I wish for someone to speak on my behalf. These men will not listen to my story. They do not believe that I mean no harm."
Lycum's readying a spell just in the background. No one can really tell, but he's like readying.
How am I to leave you, Orc? My name is Emeraldi.
And
Paladin, Baranor, True Silver. Who are you?
And just as a general point of knowledge, you guys all would know that the Orcish Empire, out of the Many Arrow stronghold, is surprisingly civilized. It's not the traditional orcs of yore, in which they're exclusively warlike, they're exclusively tribal. They're no longer like that. They are a true empire led by a king. So the prejudice of the past, though, still does hold sway.
I see that you are a holy man, and I have heard tale of the heroes of Everlund and your accomplishments. I, too, am a man of faith.
Lycum's like 5 feet plus behind the group anyway, just like over there on his own, just like hanging out. Like,
go on.
Just glaring this guy get down.
Say more.
I am called by Gan Urok of the Oregon clan. I am a scholar of sorts. And I mean no harm to the people here. I merely heard tale of great conflict and came to seek it out.
Well, you've certainly come to the right place, and apparently you must have been waiting for us because we are the heroes of Everlund.
And at this, the guard just kind of, looks at you all, and he briefly recognizes, actually, he only recognizes Beetle and Emeraldi at this point, and he just kind of looks strangely at this weird elven creature behind you all that seems to be more feral than anything else. And then
he's with us.
Eyes banner a little bit. And so he says, I can't just let an orc into the city.
Oh my gosh. Banner's just rolling his...
I march right up to the guard. Well, sir, then you'll have the council to answer to, because we're on council business and we require his information.
Make your persuasion check.
Oh, this will be entertaining.
Oh my goodness.
Hey, I get a plus zero to persuasion. It's not a negative, at least. Yes!
That's all right. I'm coming to the...
The guy just kind of crosses his arm. I don't care if you're the king of the north. You're not letting that orc in.
All right. Banner's going to walk.
Has
he's going to leave Lycum in the corner.
Has this orc committed a crime?
Well, no, but he's an orc. No orcs allowed in Neverlund. They've never been allowed in Neverlund.
So you're saying you're racist,
my friend,
Ron.
Change comes in the winds.
This might not mean much.
Is to try to move a mountain.
The guard just.
Banner's going to walk over to the guard and give him a hard stare and be like, do you know that they're on their way to Councilwoman Verrill's estate right this minute? Do you really want to tell her that you stopped them from completing their mission? Give us the orc and let us be on our way. Or there will be hell to pay.
Make an intimidation check. The guard looks, his fire just kind of starts to fade a little bit, and he looks a little uncertain of himself, and he looks at you, Gan, and he looks at the group, and Then he throws his spear over his shoulder and goes, "Fine, but I want everyone's names, because if something goes wrong, they're the ones, your guys are going to be the ones that they're going to look for." And he stomps over, unlocks your chains, Gans, throws down the shackles, and sets his spear down and pulls out a scroll, and he goes, "So what's your names?" And he takes you guys' names.
Do I have to give him my name? Can I give him Seymour Butts?
Yes, you can.
Banner gives him Seymour Butts.
I give him a name, Pia Spoff.
Lycum says his name in Elven with a little bit of a growl at the end. So it's like a little bit of like Direwolf as well as Sylvan.
And at that, the guard just kind of looks at you, Lycum, and he just writes, "Elven dude."
Look,
I take the time to give the guard a very deep bow before giving him.
I know that you've done your duty, but on my honor as a paladin, he's in my custody.
Yeah, well, you better see that he does no wrong, dwarf. Emerald, is it?
My own responsibility.
Banner.
Emeraldi, hammer strike.
Well, your reputation precedes you, and you, he looks at you, Beetle. What was the name you gave him?
Piss off. Sounds like piss off.
And he just kind of smirks at you because, you know, he's heard about the protectors. So, well, what are you waiting for? There's food and ale in there. Time's a wasting. And he gives you, again, a parting glare as he turns back towards his station near the guardhouse.
So, have my belongings.
All right, pace off. Why don't we head out of here?
Hold on, guys. What'd you say, Gan?
May I have my belongings? I am partial to that walking stick.
Of course. He waves towards your belongings. It's just laying along the wall of the guardhouse. And your walking stick is actually leaned up against the wall.
All right, I'll pick him up, and Gan starts following behind the group.
All right. So as you guys enter once again into Everlund,
go ahead.
We're not going to go too much further. Maybe another 15 minutes. So, but what do you guys want to do?
Once we get out of earshot. Oh, go ahead.
I was just going to say, as we're walking away, I was just going to turn to Lycum and go, "This orc's more civilized than me. I don't think you got to worry about him."
And as he says that, I look at Gan, and I'm like, "Who are you, and why are you here?"
I am Gan Uruk of the Urugin clan. My clan raises warriors. My clan raises scholars, thinkers. I am all of these. I am here because I have heard of great conflict in the area. And if there is nothing that I am, if there is anything I am, excuse me, I slipped up. I am a creature of change. Where conflict is, there is change.
What type of conflict do you look to change?
Any. Conflict need not be destructive.
But what do you know about the orc god Yertrus?
Of Yertrus, I know nothing. My allegiance and my bloodline is to Grums.
Anybody know who Grums is?
Grums. Grumsh.
Emeraldi would definitely know who Grums is. He's the primary orcish god that the orcs follow. The orcish god of war, who always require the orcs to always be raiding, always be fighting, always be striving. Though the modern orc has changed that a lot. They have, let's just say, found an acceptable outlet for the more civilized society that they're trying to be. They've not been able to quite throw off that preconception entirely because they have, you know, hundreds if not thousands of years of history going against them. But they're trying. So what do you guys want to do? And I would remind you of Dawn and Jay, currently, as far as I'm aware of, is still kind of hanging out in front of that warehouse you guys left a few hours ago.
I mean, is, I think you're on mute. Is it on the way to go to the councilwoman's estate, or is it on which is on the way to the other?
I think we need to go to the councilwoman's first.
The council, it is about 8, close to 9 o'clock at night at this point. The councilwoman's house is near the Silver Moon Gate, not far. It's approximately in that area here. Oops.
I want paid, and I'm pretty sure she's waiting up on us based on our interactions with her.
Well, I think the healing potions were supposed to be our pay, but she at least deserves a report.
It was part of your compensation.
We're still getting paid.
So. Cool. All right, so...
don't work free.
All right, so you guys make your way back to the councilwoman's estate with the wide stone stairways leading up to the arch doorway. You swear it's the same two guards, probably is, since it's not been that long, but, you know, they're shifting their feet a little bit more than they were before because, you know...
Banner gives a little nod to the one he poked in the forehead last time.
And as you pass, he actually trips you.
Can I make a dexterity save or something for this?
Yes, you can.
Is Banner at the front of the group or the back of the group?
He's apparently in the front of the group.
Oh, okay.
Have fun.
So what do you want me to make? Acrobatics or
if you're proficient, dex? If you're proficient in acrobatics, otherwise dex.
Dang it.
And you stumble, you actually fall down to one knee. You look up at the guard kind of, you know, glaring at him. His face is completely blank, as if he did nothing.
I grin. I'm like, all right. Banner likes that.
As you knock on the door, you see the same houseman, the nameless houseman. and without ado, he, as if expecting you, he ushers you into a different room this time. On the opposite wing, you see that the councilwoman is actually sitting in a chair in front of a fireplace. And as she hears you all kind of trundle in, she kind of looks up and she says, "Picked up a few stragglers, I see."
Like, I'm like sitting barely in the doorway, just like leaning against it, kind of trying to hide, but not really hiding.
Yeah, I think this one's definitely a stray.
I see what you did there.
The councilwoman's eyes kind of linger on you like them.
He stares right back.
You get the sense that she's actually a little older than you are.
Damn, she's old.
Does your character actually say that?
No, he does not. He thinks that. He thinks that, though. Like, in realizing that someone's older than him, he just kind of is like, holy crap. That she's old.
And then she takes in you again, and you see a little bit of a little bit of fire kind of enter into her eyes, but then quickly leave. Well hidden, but it was there just briefly. And then
do I notice?
You do not. Matter of fact,
did I like note this, or do I have to make an inside check for this?
Gan, you notice. No one else seems to notice.
If you wish to speak something, say it.
I welcome to my home. And it was probably the first time any of you had heard her hesitate or search for words. And then, as if bringing herself back to the moment, she says, "So, tell me, how fares Kentus? Does he sleep still?"
Kentus is at his final rest.
Final. So he awoke.
Yes, we were unable to stop the ceremony.
Tell me, what happened to my Kentus?
How much do you want to know?
Banner gives Emirati an elbow to the side of the arm, just while this is happening.
She thinks for a moment. Just assure me that he will not rise.
We saw you, my lady.
Rise.
We made doubly sure.
We gave him the honor due an paladin of Tyr. We buried him with rites, and we sent his body to flame.
Make a deception check.
I don't remember any rites being...
I think that's the first time I've ever heard Emeraldi outright lie.
It's for her own heart.
No, I get it. I get it. But that was surprising. The councilwoman kind of stares at you, Emeraldi, and it's a long stare. Matter of fact, the silence just kind of descends in the room, and it becomes a little uncomfortable. And you get the sense that she saw the lie completely. But she just kind of, after a long moment, she just kind of closes her eyes and kind of bows her head a little bit. And she says, "Very well." And she lets it pass.
I have this for you from one of the others. And I hand her the necklace of Eldath.
And as she looks at it, she goes, "Oh. Yes, I remember. I'm surprised he still had it." And she says a brief incantation. And then she sees us, she smiles. You see her smile, and she says, "Oh, this is a nice one. You should know that the wearer of this, once attuned to it, if they should fall to in battle, this will heal them once again." And for mechanical purposes, this is the amulet of rejuvenation. When dealt damage, that would take your hit points down to zero or below. The amulet automatically heals you for 2d4 plus 2 hit points. Once discharged, it takes 3 days to recharge. And obviously it won't work on the undead.
Frontline fighters. Banner says, "For what it's worth, Ketis's brother seem to be at peace now, too.
Well, I hold no such... Let's just say I don't care what happens to them. While the paladin was unwittingly tricked, these did so willingly. They made the conscious choice to betray their people and their king.
I thought, just for clarification, I was under the impression that the guy who helped us, who was the ghost, was the guy that he stabbed and murdered.
The what?
I thought the ghost that blessed us was the paladin that Ketis murdered.
Were you talking about the ghost or the
mages? Oh, I was under the impression he was buried there too. I must have been mistaken.
Right. I'm sorry. I thought you were talking about the mages.
No. I was referring to his brother paladins.
Okay.
Sorry.
And as that conversation is awkwardly ending, the houseman comes up and gives each of you a small pouch. And she nods and she says, to Emeraldi, Beetle, and Banner, containing 250 gold each. And she says, a thank you from the city of Evermont, though most will not even realize the disaster you staved off this day. And it seems like my reason for being here in Evermont no longer exists.
You're leaving?
Quite honestly, I don't know what I'm going to do. I stood guard over that vault for so long. It's true, I do care about Everlund, but at the end of the day, I was here for entirely different reasons. My position on the council and the things that I have done, all of that was just in service to my true purpose. But I am old, and I do long for home, even though it is destroyed.
Do you not also long for justice for Ketis? His whore of a goddess is trying to do gods know what, and there's... You're just going to leave while she has free reign?
Well, I understand. I'm not going to just simply up and move tomorrow. Obviously, I have arrangements to make, and there is this particular issue outstanding. I'm not going to just leave. I do have responsibilities, but let's just say I see my retirement in the near future. Assuming I live, who knows what the future may bring, to be honest, but speaking of which, you have, what can you tell me about those who would try to resurrect the paladin?
Well, he was wearing this armor, and I point to the armor that that Banner has on.
Oh, yeah, don't you have some of that bit of crystal, that giant crystal that I smashed on the floor? Maybe you should show some of those pieces.
Yeah, I pull out one of my little sacks, and it has not only the crystal pieces in it, but the orc ears.
Oh, right.
Do you take the orc ears out, too?
I do. And by the way, we found, well, the elf here found... what looked like a scouting or raiding party of Yertrus's orcs with their warg mounts, and rather handily dispatched them. But I was kind of concerned, as I think were the rest of us, that they were so close to Everlund. And they had more of the weapons that Helg was forced to make, and I gestured to Emeraldi to show her this longsword.
She sees the orc ears, and she kind of you know, takes a half step away, and she goes, yes, well, you can keep those.
No offense, I look up to, like, Gan, who's, like, three times as tall as I am.
And, but she does, Banner, she goes over to you and gets actually pretty close to you as she puts a hand on your breastplate and runs her hand over the,
Banner goes in, hold on. Banner's gonna go ahead and open up for that hug again. She's right there.
And yeah, she does ignore you, but she's paying attention to the, to the symbol on your breastplate that you had tried to scratch out. And she kind of looks up at you and she says, you best get rid of that as soon as you can. Her power is the power of corruption. I would not trust it on your chest. And she pushes you away surprisingly strongly for such a frail-looking woman. Enough that you actually had to take a step back. Not like she doesn't, like, you know, push you hard, just enough for you to just have to take a step back to regain your balance. And she says, and definitely do not wear that openly in the city. I'm sure a blacksmith can help you fix it. And she looks again with distaste at the symbol on your chest. Well, to be honest, I haven't any more information for you. The long sword, and well, like I said, you can keep the ears. I will take that as evidence, along with the invoice that I do have. And I will be speaking with the council the first thing in the morning.
Lady Verrill, may I have a moment in privacy before, just with you, without the others?
She looks a little surprised, but she gives a graceful nod. Yes, and quite frankly, it's been a long day for me. If you don't mind, I would like to retire for the evening. And she looks pointedly at the houseman who smoothly opens the door and awaits for everybody's exit. Clearly, you are being, the audience is at an end. And she turns to you, Emeraldi, and just holds up a finger as if telling you to wait behind for a moment.
Lycum kind of lingers around a little bit. He's going to be the last one out, but he also gives her a look like we need to meet up and talk after, but he doesn't actually say anything. Does that?
And she does catch your glance, and she gives you a very almost imperceptible nod as you head up. So the rest of the group exits. The room is escorted to the door where your shoes are waiting, because you were again forced to change your shoes into the house slippers, as it were. And she turns to you, Emeraldi, and she says, well, Paladin?
Just a question and a statement. First question is, did he too begin to tell lies?
No. Kentis was fully and wholly duped. He had no clue Marla's true identity nor true purpose until all of us do. You see, it was at that moment that twisted him, the shock of it, the horror of it, the realization that though he knew now, what she was. He loved her still. He believed perhaps that some part of the woman that he had fell in love with was there. I can honestly tell you that it was all a lie. It was a mirage. He fell in love with a vapor. But to him, it was all too real. It was something that he could not let go.
And my last thing is, I ask forgiveness for my error in words, and that how the battle was and how it ended. I just for some reason could not bear to tell you those details.
She gives you a fond smile as she lays a hand on your arm. She goes, my dear Emeraldi, I do understand, and I thank you for your tenderness. However, I will leave you with one word, one parting word. Faithful are the wounds of a friend. Never be afraid to tell the truth. And with that, she looks to her side where the houseman had returned to collect you, Emeraldi, and she gives the houseman a nod, and she says, until we meet again, be safe.
May Baron our true silver bless this house.
And she nods in acknowledgement, as a true diplomat would. And you make your way back out to rejoin the group as you all find yourself in front of the councilwoman's house once again. And that's where we're going to leave off tonight. And we'll pick up there on Saturday to continue on. And that'll do it for our first episode of The Protectors. Thank you for joining us. I hope you enjoyed it. And if you did, remember to hit the like button and subscribe to this channel. Look for us as we make more episodes available in the near future. Until then, this is Wraith Kind signing off. Have a great day.